Hello and welcome to KGB Bible Stories YouTube channel.
Hello. Before we get started, we want to first tell you a tip so it can be easier for you guys to find our YouTube channel. If you want to refer it to other friends and loved ones and relatives, if you write it KJB space Bible space stories, you will not be able to find it on the regular little box on the YouTube channel. So you need to search it, or if you refer to the person, they need to search the whole words together. And don't worry about capitals, okay? Just put KJB Bible Stories, the whole three words together, and that immediately the first thing that's going to pop in there is this YouTube channel. So before we start our questions and answers on the book of Matthew chapter 3, let us begin with a word of prayer.
Father in heaven, may you bless us with the knowledge of your truth always, and may you bless us with your spirit to give us discernment and understanding of all things. May Lord, it takes your spirit to understand your word. We don't want man's ideas. We want pure heavenly gospel of love. In your son Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So, questions and answers in the book of Matthew chapter 3. Let us first read the Bible verses. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea, and saying, Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah. But it is here written, Isaiah, saying, The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And the same John hath his raiment of camel's hair, and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. Then went out to him Jerusalem, and all Judea, and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generations of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were open unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So now we have read the 17 verses of Matthew chapter 3. Let's go into the questions. Question number one, what was the message that John the Baptist preached?
Question number two, was John the Baptist prophesied to come?
Question number three, what was the purpose of John the Baptist?
Question number four, where did John the Baptist live?
Question number five, The raiment of John the Baptist consists of what?
Question number six. What was the meat of John the Baptist? And no one means meat, it means what was the food of John the Baptist?
Question number seven. What words did John the Baptist tell the Pharisees and the Sadducees?
Question number eight. Was John the Baptist's message to the Pharisees and to the Sadducees a close of probation message?
Question number nine. What will happen to every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit?
Question number 10. Who is the one who will baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire?
Question number 11. Where will the wheat go and where will the chaff go?
Question number 12. Who baptized Jesus?
Question number 13. As Christ's baptism, the Spirit of God, which is the Father's Spirit, descended upon Christ, why?
Question number 14. What were the Father's words after Jesus was baptized?
Did Jesus ever sin to need to be baptized? So now we have just read the 15 questions to Matthew chapter 3. Let us go to the Bible answers.
And this time we'd like to pause it and so you can go over the answers yourself, and then we'll give you the answers right after. You can see where it says the answers right there.
Answer number one, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Let's go ahead and look at the question.
What was the message of John the Baptist, that John the Baptist preached? He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, what does he mean by that? The kingdom of heaven at hand. Now, what was the purpose of Jesus coming here? We did what? We sinned against the what? The Father. We broke the Father's law. And what did God do? God sent down Jesus in sinful flesh to do what? To bridge the gap between man. He was the middle person between divinity and humanity and everything. So he said, repent. Repent ye means repent and everything. That's why you need Jesus' character for the kingdom of heaven at hand. Christ brought the kingdom of heaven closer to man and everything. And it was through the Son that we come to the what?
To the Father.
That's why the kingdom of heaven is at hand and everything. So if we look towards Jesus and everything, and we look at Jesus, our example, and everything, and we want Jesus in our lives, we want to be like Jesus and everything, the kingdom of heaven will be at hand to us.
In other words, to say it in other words, it will be that the kingdom of heaven was made near because of the sacrifice that Jesus did for us. In other words, that through the merits of Jesus, through his righteousness, we too can enter into the kingdom of heaven.
And so it says, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That even prefigures the death of Christ on the cross and everything. He brought the kingdom of heaven to man and everything, because his death ensured victory to us if he applies the blood to us.
Definitely. Praise God.
And question number two, was John the Baptist prophesied to come? And now remember Matthew, we said that the other Matthew and everything, that the book of Matthew was specifically written for, was more specifically written for the Jews, and it does reference a lot of the Old Testament, so like I said, we're going to go to an Old Testament prophecy.
So the answer first is yes, and then we're going to go ahead and go to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3 and 4.
And Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3 and 3 and 4 says, and if you read it, says, for the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, and you see this is a verse is taken from in Matthew and everything, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight the desert of the highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And we see right now, this is very much, you can see it very much taken from Matthew and everything. So you can see right there that this is prophesied by the prophet Isaiah, or it says Isaiah, and everything in Matthew and everything. But this is the prophet Isaiah prophesying of John the Baptist to come. And if you also go now to Malachi, this is the last book of the Old Testament. You go to Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. And it says, behold, I will send Elijah the prophet. And we know right now that Elijah was what? Already passed away many years before that even the book of Malachi was written. So this is.
And that was Elijah the Tishbite.
Yeah, that was Elijah the Tishbite that you find it, especially in the book of Kings. But he was dead and passed away. So he was prophesying of another a type of Elijah to come. Behold, I will send Elijah the prophet before the coming, the great day and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I should smite the earth with the curse. So this right now, if you remember, you want to sit there and study the Bible even more, you'll see that this is prophesying of John the Baptist, which is a type of Elijah. And let's get more clear that this is talking about John the Baptist. Let's go to Luke chapter 1, verse 17. And remember, what did Malachi say? He would turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. Luke chapter 1, verse 17. And it says, if you got to read the whole chapter, if you want to read the specific verse right now, because we know this, Luke chapter 1 is talking about the birth of what, even John the Baptist and everything. You see his mother and his father being spoken of, you can see right now. And you can read the whole chapter. We're not going to go for time's sake. We're not going to read the whole chapter. It says,
but we do recommend you read it.
Yes. And it says, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. This is very well what is quoted in Malachi chapter 4, verse 6. And it says, and these be into wisdom of the just, and to make the people, and make the people prepared for the Lord. So John the Baptist was doing what? He was preparing the people for what? Christ's first coming and everything. So we see right now that he was ultimately prophesied as a come. Remember, John, and if you look at the Bible, it's that John the Baptist was more than a prophet. He was very, very important. He was much more important than even a prophet and everything. He prepared the way for Jesus to come.
Amen. So let's go to question number 3 again. What was the purpose of John the Baptist? To prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. So question number 2 and 3, they're intertwined because it's the same.
Yes. And if anyone understands the Bible right now, he's a type of Elijah. And the nation of Israel in the history of even the first Elijah, that what was happened? He was at a time of King Ahab and what? And Jezebel. There was a lot of national apostasy there and everything. It was pretty much one of the lowest points in the nation of Israel's history. And right now, if you look at right now, the time of Christ, that was one of the lowest points of time. What did it do? They did not recognize that Jesus came. They did not recognize this was prophesied of Jesus to come. And what did they do? They went to the lowest of the lows. They killed what? Jesus on a cross. So it was a very bad time in the first Elijah. And look at the bad time in the second Elijah with John the Baptist and everything. So they prefigured their times. It was a very, very big low time for the nation of Israel and everything. And the wickedness of the nation of Israel under Ahab and the wickedness of the Pharisees and Sadducees is preeminent in the Bible. You can read it. So we see that why he's the second Elijah. It says, where did John the Baptist live? And we know right now the Bible records that he lived in the what? In the wilderness.
Let's go to question number 5. The raiment of John the Baptist consists of what? Camel's hair and a leathern girdle. That word leathern means leather, okay? It's just the Bible puts it with an extra R. And also 2 Kings chapter 1 verse 8.
Now remember, it's saying the Bible says he was a type of Elijah. Look at the description of Elijah. And in 2 Kings chapter 1 verse 8, And they answered him and said, "He is a hairy man, and girded with a girdle of leather upon his loins." And he said, "It is Elijah the Tishbite." So right now we know that John the Baptist obviously wasn't a hairy man, but he wore what? He wore raiment of what? Camel's hair to look hairy. And he had what? Leather. And he girded his loins with leather. So he even looked like John the Baptist and everything. So I guess in the mind of Jesus and everything, he wanted to think of John. When he thought of John the Baptist, they wanted to think of Elijah also. Because what? Ancient Israel had the what? The Old Testament scriptures and everything. So he wanted to bring in the mind that this is a type of Elijah.
Question number 6. What was the meat of John the Baptist? Locust and wild honey. The locust is not Karev, but it was a clean insect. My husband's going to read Leviticus 11, verse 22.
Okay. And we understand ancient Israel, their diet was actually controlled by how the Lord wanted. They were not to eat blood. They were not to eat unclean animals. Like they weren't allowed.
No fat of animal.
Yeah, like the swine. They were not allowed to eat pig because pig was an unclean animal. It says, we'll begin in verse number 24. All the fowls that creep upon all four shall be an abomination to you. And yet these ye may eat of every flying creeping thing which goeth upon all four, which have legs above the feet, and that leap withal upon the earth. Even these things ye may what? Eat. The locust after his what?
Kind.
His kind. And the bald locust after his kind, and the beetle after his kind, and the grasshopper after his kind. So you can see right now is...
So they were allowed to eat a locust.
Yes, they were allowed to eat a locust because it was a clean animal. And you know, locusts in the ancient Israel time, they did what? When there was a locust plague, they ate all the vegetation that was on. So I believe locust will always be a clean animal because they just eat vegetation. They eat barks of trees. They eat all the little things that they
plants
grow.
Plants and leaves.
Plants and everything. So yeah. So I would say, like, most Seventh-day Adventists say that he ate carob, but I would say more likely he just ate what would be like the form of a grasshopper.
And when you look up the root word of locust here in Matthew chapter 3, it's not a carob, okay? It's a literal insect. Let's go to question number 7.
Okay, what words did John the Baptist tell the Pharisees and the Sadducees? And I'm going to turn over to Matthew. Once again, 3. And he said, what did he say? And he said, let's read verse number 17. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said, "O generation of vipers, who have warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" And we're going to get more on this question right now. He says, right now, what is he doing? He's actually, right now in this time period and everything, he was to prepare the make the way straight, the crooked paths to be straight. And we understand right now, what the Pharisees and the Sadducees, if you look at the time, they were responsible for killing Jesus and everything. They were responsible for a lot of things. And everything. So right now is.
But even before they killed Jesus, they had sinned. That's why they couldn't accept Jesus.
They exalted more the law of Moses instead of the Ten Commandment law, and they even went above and beyond the law of Moses. So right now is, he's giving a message to them of the doom to come to the Pharisees and Sadducees.
Let's go to question number 8. Was John the Baptist's message to the Pharisees and to the Sadducees a close approbation message? Let's go to answer number 8. Yes, it is. Implied in the verses of Matthew chapter 3, verses 7 through 10.
Okay, let's read that. Let's read it again. I just read verse 7, but let's read it again. And look what it says in verse number 6. It says, and they were baptizing him in Jordan, confessing their sins. So the ones, the Pharisees did not want to confess their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, "O generation of vipers, who have warned you to flee from the wrath to come. Bring forth, therefore, fruit, meat for repentance. So he's warning them what? He's warning them, you should be bringing forth meat to repentance. But
you should be coming with a contrite heart and get baptized.
Yes, but what is it? You know, we know the story, read the Bible and everything, even the New Testament, that was not the case on many of them. There was some Pharisees, there was some Sadducees that did repent, but a majority of them did not. And it says, think not to say within yourselves, ye have Abraham as your father. And you can also go to John chapter 8, verses, like around verse 40 and everything. You see, this is the same argument that the Pharisees and Sadducees had with Jesus. They kept saying they're of Abraham's seed. And they're saying, no, don't think you're of Abraham's seed. For I say unto you, that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto what? Abraham. They're saying, don't think because you're the lineage of Abraham that you're of any on any safe ground. God will raise up the seed of Abraham and everything, which means not all that is Israel shall be Israel. Not all that is of the Jews will be saved. And let's read the last verse and everything it says. And let's read it says now and look what it says. And now also the axe is laid to the what? To the root of the tree. What do you have when you lay the axe root to? You cut off that tree. That tree will no longer live because it is you're killing that tree and everything. Therefore, every tree which bringeth forth not good fruit is hewed down and cast into the fire. So he was a what? It was a warning message to them. Because you did not bring meat to repentance, God is going to ultimately hew you down. And you're gonna receive the second death.
Amen. There we go. Move forward. Mm-hmm. Let's go to question number 9.
And question number 9, it says, what will happen to every tree which bringeth forth not good fruit? It's upon the same question.
The same subject.
It will be hewed down and cast into what? The fire. That will be cast into what fire? Hellfire, which is at the what? End of the world. Hellfire is not burning now. It's at the end of the world.
Let's go to question number 10.
Who is the one who will baptize with the Holy Ghost and with fire? It says what? It says Jesus Christ. And right now, we want to also go to Luke chapter 3. Verse 16, which will say the same thing, what we see right here. Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let everything be established. Everywhere be established, everything. And it says, and this is, like I said, Luke chapter 3 is talking about the baptism of Jesus.
And this chapter 3, we're getting a little more deeper.
And it says, and John answered and said unto them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I cometh, and that's Jesus. The latchet whose shoes I am not worthy to loose, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Amen. Like I said, after Jesus died and walked 40 days on the what? Earth with his disciples, what did he do? He breathed on his disciples the what? The Holy Spirit, Ghost. The Holy Ghost and everything. So he said.
Let's go to question 11. Where will the wheat go and where will the chaff go? Where will the wheat go, and where will the chaff go? Answer number 11. The wheat will go into the garner, and the chaff will be burned with unquenchable fire.
So the wheat here are the ones that have the righteousness of Christ,
amen,
which will go to the garner, which means they will be in the new Jerusalem with Jesus. Amen. And the ones that are chaff, and you got to understand.
And the chaff is the one that doesn't have the wheat.
Yes, and if you understand agriculture, when they do wheat, they have to remove the chaff and everything.
Yes.
Yeah, the Bible says that terminology, but you also can look it up on the internet, how wheat is done. We'll go into unquenchable fire, which means we'll be in hellfire. That would be the wicked.
And unquenchable, this is the word that they use in the Bible, but it's not literally unquenchable. If you put the chaff of wheat, how long would it take for it to burn? Maybe we could say 30 seconds. So that's how long, but this one will be human beings who reject the gospel. So how long does it take for a body to burn? Of course, the body is not unquenchable, right? If we're unquenchable, then that means we're not mortals.
Yes.
We are something else.
To say that there is a hellfire that will be forever burning will basically say that sin will never be eradicated. Mm. So if hellfire lasts forever, God says sin will be destroyed in death.
And I'm gonna get ready to do a study about that.
So ultimately, like the Catholics believe that purgatory pretty much lasts for so long and everything. Well, I don't believe they do purgatory. They believe you got to burn in fire. But there's some people that believe that hellfire lasts forever and everything. But
no, they still believe in the purgatory.
You know, so right now that. So basically, sin has to be burned up in the everlasting fire, or don't denote on the words too much and everything, because sin has to die, which means sin ultimately must die, which means there's not an eternity burning hellfire.
And remember that it is this earth where the wicked die. So if the wicked are dying and it's a multitude of them, then that means this earth is never going to be purified, and that means this won't be the new earth that the Bible promised in the book of Psalm and a bunch of verses all over the Bible.
And the author of sin is who? The devil. And God says that the devil will die. The Bible says that the devil will die.
How long would it take? We don't know.
Satan will burn longer than anyone, but God will destroy Satan and everything. Amen. Hence, that's proof that there is no eternally burning hellfire.
Amen. Let's go to question number 12. Who baptized Jesus? And that's an easy answer. Ooh. John the Baptist. Let's go to question number 13. At Christ's baptism, the Spirit of God, which is the Father's Spirit, descended upon Christ. Why? Let's go to answer number 13. Okay. My husband's going to go ahead and read that.
Okay. Now we understand, like, why did the Spirit descend upon Jesus and everything? You know? And we got to understand, before I read the answer right now, is what was the purpose of Jesus to come? What was the purpose? Remember, Jesus was begotten of the Father and everything. He wasn't created. He was begotten of the Father and everything. So right now, what Jesus was there to do what? To show the character of the Father to the world. Jesus was the middle ground and everything. So basically, God wanted to do what? Show his love and his kindness to the world right now. And he did it through his son, Jesus. He did everything through his son, Jesus, and everything. So basically, the Spirit of the Father went through the son and that showed the entire world. Okay, let's read it. It says, and there shall come.
Where are you reading from?
I'm reading Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. It says, and therefore shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of what? Of wisdom. Of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, of might, the Spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of the Lord and everything. So remember, when Christ came on this earth, he did everything and through the what?
Through the strength
of the Father. His wisdom was through the Father.
He didn't do it on his own.
Christ had his own wisdom, but he didn't do it through his own divinity.
Yeah,
his own divinity and everything.
So he had to do it through humanity with the strength of the Father.
Yeah, through the strength of the Father. That's why he got the Spirit of the Father running through him and everything. That's why it is. That's why.
In him.
And it says, and shall make him quick of understanding into the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, and everything. So the Spirit of the Father is going to show right judgment through Christ and everything. But all righteousness shall, it says, but with all righteousness shall judge the poor and reprove the equality of the meek of the earth, and he shall smite. No, equity. Equity of the meek of the earth, and he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and out of the breath of his lips, he shall slay the wicked. Now let's turn to Isaiah chapter 42. And one of the most important things right now is the Spirit of the Father is what is. If you read the Old Testament, this is the Old Testament was. God wanted the nation of Israel to do what? To bring the message of the gospel to the Jews, to the Gentiles and everything. And they failed to do it. And everything. So you see right here. Behold, my servant. This is talking about Jesus. Whom I behold, my elect, whom my soul delighteth. I have put my spirit upon him, and he shall bring forth judgment unto the Gentiles and everything. And that word judgment doesn't mean literal judgment, like he's going to judge them wickedly. No, he wants to bring righteous judgment unto the Gentiles. You can read the Bible and everything. So right now, God put the Spirit of the Father to bring what? The message of the gospel to the Gentiles.
Let's go to question number 14.
What were the father's words? I say words after Jesus was baptized.
There's a little typo. Forgive us. Answer number 14.
It says, "This is my beloved son, in whom I am what well pleased." Amen. And everything.
Let's go to answer number. Pardon me. Question number 15. This is my favorite question out of all. It says, did Jesus ever sin to need to be baptized? Because remember, John the Baptist was preaching the baptism of repentance. So repenting of sins. So did Jesus ever sin to need to be baptized? Answer number 15, no. Let's go ahead and read 1 Peter chapter 1.
1 Peter chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. It says, whom I believed in God and raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God, seeing he had purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit, being unfeigned love of the brethren, seeing that ye love one another.
Are you in First Peter?
Yes, First Peter.
So it must be Second Peter.
Must be Second Peter.
I apologize again here. Okay, you guys, so it's not 1 Peter chapter 1. It's 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 and 22. And it says, for even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Let's go ahead and read those steps in verse 22. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. So, yes, Jesus never sinned. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5.
So example, why did Jesus need to be baptized if he did not sin? He was just left in an example about baptism. It means he did not get baptized because he needed sin. John the Baptist said, you should be baptizing me, not me baptizing you. Because John the Baptist was a sinner, not Christ.
Amen. So I am now in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to read verses 19 to 21, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Let's put the keynote on verse 21. For he has made him to be sin for us who knew no sin. Let's do that again. Who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him.
So what does that mean?
Once again, Jesus never sinned.
Jesus never sinned. No, he took upon the sins of the world upon him, but did not sin.
Exactly.
And everything. So the sins of the world were laid upon one that was sinless, that he can basically die for everyone's sins and everything. So he could pay the penalty of sins. And like I said, the verse says, the Father was in the Son, reconciling the world unto himself.
Amen.
Some of our answers will show that and everything.
So now I am in 1 John chapter 3, verse 5. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Last verse, Hebrews chapter 4.
Hebrews chapter. Okay. And last verse is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 5. This is a famous verse. Most people can quote it.
For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like us we are, yet without sin. So Jesus was tempted. We are tempted. But Jesus, what? He did not sin, because he was without sin. And he was doing everything through the strength of the Father. And so we have no excuse. We can have the exact same experience. If Jesus would have relied on his own divinity, then we can have an excuse and say, wait a minute, Lord, I don't have divinity like your son does. So guess what? I'm going to be a sinner forever and ever and ever. But hold it. Jesus didn't do that. And so we can rely on the strength of the Father for us not to commit iniquity and to have a strong hold when the temptations come. So I hope you enjoyed Matthew chapter 3, questions and answer. We appreciate you coming and watching this. Be so kind to share it with your friends and loved ones and let them come and learn the word of the Lord. And let us go ahead and close with a word of prayer.
Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you we can come and study to the book of Matthew. And we pray that more than anything that will anyone that hears this or watches this video will want to find salvation in Jesus Christ. Lord, as the Bible said, you the Father will through the Son reconcile the word unto yourself. So Jesus needs to be our all in all. We need to look totally unto Jesus for our strength. In our weaknesses, in our trials and victory, we must ultimately come to the foot of the cross. In your Son Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. See you until next time. God loves you. Bye-bye.